Hello everyone, welcome to church today. I just want to say before we get into the service that I am in need of a little bit of a trim here and there. I feel like a bit of a mountain man at the moment. I have to confess, I am not doing very well at looking after my own personal appearance with the amount of days and hours that I'm working here right now. So you're just going to have to live with it. If you're not happy about it, make an official complaint. And I'll take it and I'll tear it up and we'll leave it there. It's great to welcome you to worship with us today and to hear the word of God. We're going to be listening to a message by Mark Batterson today. And he's starting a new series from the book of Ephesians. So let me read these verses to you from Ephesians chapter 1 before we get into the service any further. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus. I'm writing to God's holy people in Ephesus, who are faithful followers of Christ Jesus. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family, by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. So we praise God for the glorious grace that he has poured out on us who belong to his dear Son. He is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his Son and forgave our sins. Listen now. He has showered his kindness on us along with all wisdom and understanding. That's the opening to the book of Ephesians. Just before our children were born, we went on kind of one last holiday, myself and Sarah, before starting a family. We thought this would be the last holiday we have by ourselves until we retire or until our kids leave home. Where do we want to go? And we went to Turkey for 2 weeks. It was my birthday while we were there, and we spent my birthday walking around the ancient ruins of Ephesus. One of the greatest days of my life, of our lives, actually. I won't go into all the experiences that we had there, but it was quite phenomenal, including standing on the stage of the very amphitheater where Paul preached to the believers and the non-believers in Ephesus, saying that there is only one God. We found ancient symbols scratched into the stone, the oldest symbols of Christianity back then, secret symbols, incredible. We went into the second biggest library in the world of its time that was in Ephesus. I met a Christian artist there who'd been praying desperately to meet with a pastor on that day, as her pastor had been taken by the authorities and put in prison for preaching the gospel in Turkey. Amazing, amazing experience. So the book of Ephesus finds a real warm place in my heart. Hope you enjoy the ministry today, and thank you so much for being a part of it. Keep an ear out for some important announcements coming up through the service today, and kids, don't go anywhere. We have kids time for you again, of course, as usual. Welcome, everyone.
Victory comes in his name, by his word, not by power. stronger than all.
As we worship in unity, Jesus our Lord, victory comes in His name, by His word, not by power, not by might, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Not by power, not by might,
but by my Spirit,
says the Lord. Not by power, not by might,
not by might,
but by my Spirit.
In other news, let me tell you about something that we are thrilled to be able to announce today, and that is that a week today we will be having our very first Back to Live services Sunday morning.
Oh, yes! Let's go!
That's Sunday the 27th. Now, it's going to start with a kids program. That's what we're going to be doing. To put it in a nutshell, that's to do with the size of the room, the type of restrictions that are upon children and educational environments, and also, very importantly, the spiritual welfare of our children who are back to school right now, learning regular lessons and everything else, but need that spiritual impact, that spiritual input in their lives. That means that those of you who are at home will still get a service like you've been getting recently on Facebook, live on Sunday morning at 10:30. Over and above all of that, we truly believe that the central heartbeat of Discover Church needs to be our children and young people. And so on the 27th, at 10:30 in the morning, our children are gonna gather for a 1-hour program in the St. Andrew's upper room where we've been meeting for the last few months. Those parents and grandparents that bring their children on that Sunday morning, and only parents or grandparents who bring their children, will go into the main gymnasium at St. Andrew's there, where we'll have a television and sound set up so that you can watch and be a part of the live stream that everyone else is taking part in. You'll be socially distanced, you'll have to be masked and separated and so on, but there is a way that we can do this, and that's what we intend to do. We'll give more details as the week goes on. Sunday the 27th, please pray into that. Our team are already working on the content of that service. We're having to be very creative, as you can imagine, because of certain things that we can't do. But we believe that God is calling us to do this in this particular way at this particular time. That's the direction that we're taking at the moment, and we pray that you'll support it and that you will soak it in prayer, because we really need that. God bless you, everybody. That's the news for now.
Bye. 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 B the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Ooh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes.
to your grace today. You've come to join us so long before our lives, to raise our voice along and we see your faithful hand, your mercy without end, the King who bled and died, the God who sacrificed, so be enthroned upon the praises of a thousand generations. You are worthy, Lord, our all. And unto you, the slain and risen King, we lift our voice with heaven, singing, worthy, Lord, our all. All through this life, we say, highest. promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, our God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, our God, that is who you are. We declare, way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. As we sing
of months ago, I'm out running, and this song, Be Enthroned, I got it on my ear, my AirPods, and I'm running, and there's just no way, be enthroned upon the praises of 1,000 generations, and I don't know, there's just no way I can't not raise my hands, and so I'm running. And I'm running like this and I'm start throwing it like I'm worshiping in church. And of course, a car kind of sneaks up behind me and drives by. And I have no idea what they're thinking. Listen, those who don't hear the music think the dancer's mad. But I want to tell us something right here. When the praise goes up, His grace and His peace begin to invade our lives. God, would you invade our lives with your grace? Oh, but I don't deserve it. That's the point. You can't deserve it. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. We're going to talk about it next week. You are beloved by Him. Lord, we pray your grace. An extra measure. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We know it as the Lord's Prayer. But it's more than a prayer. It is our mission. It is our vision. We talk a lot about going to heaven, and there's nothing wrong with that, but we get this backwards. Heaven is not just a future tense reality. It is a present tense reality. Now, I know that that's a little counterintuitive, might even be countercultural, but heaven is invading earth right here, right now. How? How? Well, when we love our enemies, heaven invades earth. When we pray for those who persecute us or bless those who curse us, heaven invades earth. When we care for the poor, the widow, the orphan, when we exercise faith, hope, and love, heaven invades earth. When a relationship is reconciled, when someone experiences miraculous healing, when justice flows like a river, heaven invades earth. This weekend, we begin a new series, a new season. This is more than a title. This is our prayer. This is our mission, heaven on earth. Man, that trailer was this beautiful picture of what the book of Ephesians is all about. Let me butterfly cut this book. 6 chapters, 155 verses. You can read it in about 20 minutes flat. Klein Snodgrass said, pound for pound, Ephesians may be the most influential document in history. Now, that's a pretty bold statement, but give it 12 weeks and see if you don't add an amen. Paul is writing around 62 AD, and this is sort of like Dr. King's letter from a Birmingham jail. Paul is in prison in Rome. I've actually stood in that prison cell in Rome where Paul is purported to have written this letter. He's writing to the church at Ephesus, but we think it's a circular letter, so it went to Ephesus, and then probably forwarded by FedEx to some of these other churches in Asia Minor. The first half of Ephesians, it's all about this heavenly realm. We have been blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing. Where? In the heavenly realm. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. Where? In the heavenly realm. All power and dominion is his. That heavenly reality is our identity in chapter one. It's our destiny in chapter two. It's our authority in chapter three. And then Paul flips this script, and there's this word therefore kind of right in the middle of the book. Now, preachers love this because you got to find out what the therefore is there for. And this is where we shift to the earthly realm. It's all about behavior informed by belief. It's about culture transformed by Christ. This is heaven invading earth. And so the net result is unity in chapter four. It's maturity in chapter five. And then finally, it's security in chapter six. And so ready or not, here we go. Ephesians 1, verse 1, and we'll put it on the screen. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace and peace to you from our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We read right past Paul. We read right past apostle. Listen, Paul and apostle go together like Ruth and Chris, right? Steakhouse, okay? But this is an ancient oxymoron. Listen, before becoming Paul, his name was Saul. He was a domestic terrorist who hunted Christians like wild animals. He is the least likely person on the planet to become an apostle. And listen, so if you're watching this weekend, you aren't sure you're a first round draft pick. Okay, welcome to the team, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus. Job 11:6 says, true wisdom has two sides. Now, you've heard me say this many, many times. Truth is found in the tension of opposites, okay? Lots of two-sided truths in scripture, and you have to flip the coin to see both sides. And I think this is a great example. You've got another chiasm right here. From the heavenly point of view, we're saints. This is how God sees us. That is our position in Christ. But from an earthly POV, we are faithful in Christ Jesus. There's this process called sanctification. We are being conformed to the image of Christ. So in Christ, you are perfectly and positionally sanctified. Your sin is forgiven and forgotten. There is no record of wrong. You are the righteousness of Christ. All of it, right here, right now. Practically speaking, sanctification is a process. You are a work in progress. So am I. God is working his plans, his purposes, his promises in your life. And so you are sanctified, past tense, that moment you put your faith in Christ, but you are being sanctified, present tense. Well, which is it, Pastor Mark? No, it's not either or. It is both and. And that'll make a lot more sense as we move forward. absolutely critical as we talk about identity formation in Christ. Now, let me back up the bus a little bit. I want to take us on a field trip this weekend to ancient Ephesus. If content is king, then context is queen. So let me give us a little bit of backdrop as we begin to look at this book. Ephesus, one of the largest cities in the ancient world, best guess, few hundred thousand people, had an amphitheater that sat 25,000 people. I'm going to show you a picture of these ancient ruins. Think Russell Crowe and Gladiator. Ephesus was a port city. It sat at the intersection of four major trade routes, and it was Wall Street. This is where the Caesars opened up their offshore bank accounts. Now, even more important than all of that is the Temple to Artemis. Actually ranks as one of the seven ancient wonders of the world, four times the size of the Parthenon, 127 columns if you're keeping score at home. I'll show you that artist rendering. A few years ago, read this book titled The Geography of Genius. Fascinating book about how different geographies have a unique genius to them. You've got Athens, Greece, 6th century BC, a lot of philosophers. You've got Florence, Italy, 14th century, a lot of artists, right? And then you've got even Silicon Valley, 20th century, and a lot of technological breakthroughs. And so those geographies and demographies are marked by a unique genius. Okay, are you still with me? Let me take this a little bit further. I think different cities have different personalities. Have you found this to be true? They have a unique tone, a unique tenor. They even have a unique pace, and there's a word for it, urban metabolism. But I want to take it even a step further than that. I think different places have different idols. There are powers and principalities. And I think it's our responsibility to identify those idols. Why? So that we can operate in the opposite spirit. We just finished the book of Daniel. Is this not what Daniel did? He would not be named or tamed by Babylonian culture, live counterculture for 70 years. I think we're called to do the same. Now, we'll talk a little bit more about this in Upper Zoom, but I do wonder if political correctness is one of those powers or principalities right here in Washington, D.C. Question, would you rather be biblically correct or politically correct? Because sometimes they are at odds with each other, and I'm just going to say it. I think sometimes it's harder to be biblically correct when you sit in the shadow of the Capitol, the White House, and the Supreme Court. Long story short, Ephesus is all about Artemis. Idols all over the city. She is their patron goddess, the goddess of fertility. And so when sailors would dock at Ephesus, they were greeted by signs. Some of these signs still exist that would point them to the nearest brothel. To say that the city was sensual would be an understatement. The Temple of Artemis would have been surrounded by temple prostitutes every year. They celebrated the festival of Artemis, and they would take to the streets of Ephesus, and they would carry this statue of Artemis down to the harbor, almost like a Thanksgiving Day float, and they would, in a sense, baptize her in that water and wash the statue of Artemis, believing that it would restore her virginity. Now, I know that we have a lot of different ages listening, and so I want to be careful right here, but let's just say that she lost it and they lost it by the time they got back to the temple. In Ephesians 5, Paul is talking about marriage as a metaphor for the church, and here's what he says. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her so that he might sanctify her. How? Having cleansed her by the washing of water Are you getting where this is going? With the word. We read right past this. The Ephesians would have known exactly what Paul is referencing. He is flipping the script and he's calling these Christians to live counterculture. How? Well, in a culture where there were very few sexual boundaries, Paul is advocating monogamy, sex. It's a sacred covenant between a husband and a wife. It was countercultural 2,000 years ago, and it is once again. You need a biblical theology of sexuality if you're gonna live countercultural, and I might add, and love everybody who doesn't believe the way that you do. I've never seen a statue of Artemis, but she is alive and well. We follow Christ in a culture that parades Artemis through the streets. All right, how are we doing? Let's keep going. A few weeks ago, talked about this Jewish hermeneutic called Pardes. Four levels of learning, four levels of study, kind of different ways of engaging scripture at different levels. And so level one is Peshat. It is a plain reading of scripture. And I want to say there is nothing wrong with reading the Bible devotionally. In fact, this is such a great place to start. You do not need a seminary degree to hear the still small voice of the Spirit. That said, I kind of think of Peshat as like the 13% of the iceberg that's above the surface of the water. I mean, come on, there is 87% beneath the surface. And so I won't share all of these levels, but the third level is Deresh, and it's connecting the dots. I would liken this to a Google search that produces lots of hyperlinks. It is letting scripture interpret scripture, and that's what we want to do this weekend. About a decade before writing this letter, Paul went on three missionary journeys, visited Ephesus twice, and I'm going to show you a map of that third missionary journey just to get you oriented. It starts in Antioch, which is really a home church for Paul, a little family reunion in Tarsus, which is where Paul is from, and then he heads west, and I bet you'll recognize some of these cities. You've got Thessalonica, you've got Philippi, Athens, and then he doubles back. Now, what the itinerary doesn't reveal is how long Paul spent in each of these cities. Of all the churches that Paul planted, ready? He spends more time in Ephesus than anywhere else, at least 2 years. And it may have been the most discipled church in the ancient world. Paul is writing to people that he pastored, okay? People he baptized and discipled, people that he married and families where he had done burials. I mean, these are people that he knew by name. Now, if you have the Bible, I want you to turn over to Acts 19. It's the backdrop for a lot of what we're going to look at over these coming 12 weeks. When Paul arrives, there are only 12 disciples in Ephesus. That's it, but that's all it takes. Give God 12 people who go all in, and it might turn into 2 billion a couple millennia later. Now, here's a fascinating thing to me. They have only heard about John's baptism. And so they have no idea who the Holy Spirit is. Come on, if you try to follow Jesus without the help of the Holy Spirit, good luck with that, okay? When we get to chapter 5, it says, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Present imperative verb. Keep on being filled with the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, I am below average. With the help of the Holy Spirit, game time who? Let me highlight four things that are happening here in Acts 19. If you're taking notes, you can jot these down. One, you've got unbelievable miracles happening in Ephesus. It says that their handkerchiefs that touched the disciples were used to heal people. Like, what? And I say, do it again, Lord, do it again. I'm believing for a supernatural demonstration of God's love and power. We have experienced a lot of miracles. I don't think we've seen anything yet. You wait and see, or better yet, taste and see. Two, you've got radical repentance. Now, this is a key ingredient when it comes to revival. Radical repentance sets the stage for radical reconciliation, which sets the stage for revival. And I might add Reformation in the church and Renaissance in culture. Long story short, the Ephesians were incredibly spiritual. They also dabbled in the occult. And so when you begin to follow Christ, like that's where you look, okay? So what do you do with all of these sorcery scrolls or books that they had? I mean, this is pretty amazing. An epic bonfire in Acts 19. They burned the boats. They burned the bridge. It says that the books were valued at 50,000 drachma. Now, you know me well enough that I'm going to do the math. And so a drachma is a day's wage. I multiplied it by the average daily wage in D.C. This bonfire, they burned $9,850,000 in D.C. dollars. Three, you've got incredible courage. The Ephesians actually riot in the streets. And so they're dragging some of these Christians into the amphitheater. Now, 1 Corinthians 15, Paul references this moment. He says, I fought with wild beasts in Ephesus. Now, I want to be honest here. We don't know whether this is literal or figurative. In fact, I think I translate it literally. But one way or the other, Paul is, you have got to live counterculture when you've got people rioting in the streets. They actually shout for 2 hours, great is Artemis of the Ephesians. When you mess with someone's idols, it may just incite a riot. Now, finally, Paul held daily discussions in the lecture hall of Tyrannus from 10 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So 5 days a week, 5 hours a day, 6 days a week. And that is 3,120 hours. And so that's about a third of the way to that 10,000 hour rule in 2 years flat. And I wonder if that's why this letter is much less corrective than, say, Corinthians, and far more proactive. The only ceiling on your intimacy with God and your impact on the world is daily spiritual disciplines. God is shifting us from a weekly mindset to a daily rhythm. And I'm not saying you have to give them 5 hours. Listen, give them 5 minutes. And that really is the challenge. Would you sign up? ncc.re/daily. You can download our brand new app. You give God 5 minutes and then see what happens. Why? Because we're not just going to study Ephesians. We're going to do Ephesians. Let's follow their example, daily church, Monday to Friday. Now, all of that adds up to verse 17. The name of the Lord was magnified. All of that adds up to verse 20. The word of God spread widely. The gospel brings a city to its knees. The gospel shifts an entire socioeconomic system on its axis. They put idolatry out of business. They experience this radical reconciliation as they tear down the dividing wall of hostility in Ephesians 2. And I love verse 23. There was no small commotion. Come on, do it again, God. We are not just trying to build a church. We are trying to bless a city to the third and fourth generation. All right, that's a lot of context. It's a lot of backdrop. I'm going to go back to verse 1. We're going to look at two words, and then we're done. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful to Christ Jesus. Here it is. Grace and peace to you from our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. All of Paul's epistles start with the same salutation. Wonder twin powers activate, form of grace, form of peace. Grace and peace set the tone, shift the atmosphere, start revolutions and stop riots. I'm gonna take these one at a time. We'll start with grace. It is the unmerited favor of God. Mercy is not getting what you deserve. Grace is getting what you do not deserve. The only way you can qualify for it is by not qualifying for it. And listen, the guy who is writing this letter knows a little something about it. Paul self-identifies as the worst of sinners. What that tells me is he knew an awful lot about the grace of God. Let me pause right here. I'm deeply concerned about cancel culture. One wrong word, one false step, subscription canceled. We are writing people off left and right. Well, double entendre right there. Work hard at this, okay? The good news, there is a vaccine for cancel culture, and it is called grace. Jesus was full of grace and truth. Truth means I'm going to be honest with you no matter what. Grace means I'm going to love you no matter what. It's loving people that you don't even like. And you know what? That's usually the people who don't look like us, vote like us, or think like us. Jerry Bridges said this, "Our worst days are never so bad that you are beyond the reach of God's grace, and your best days are never so good that you are beyond the need of God's grace. Every day is a day of relating to God on the basis of his grace alone." That is so good. The gospel starts with grace, and his grace is sufficient. And that's a word for someone this weekend. I feel it in my spirit. You needed it, and now you know it. His grace is sufficient in your life. A few weeks ago, Laura and I did this Listen and Learn series, and we were talking about restorative justice, and we interviewed Marcus Bullock. Man, he is a new friend of mine. He made a mistake when he was 15, carjacked someone, got tried as an adult, spent 8 years in prison from the age of 15 to the age of 23. His mom wrote him a letter every day. He said, "Mom, don't do it." She didn't listen. She would send him pictures of a hamburger and say, "Someday you're gonna eat this." She would send him pictures of a mattress and say, "Someday you're gonna sleep on this." I was so moved by his story and by his spirit that I had to ask him the question, how does a 15-year-old kid survive 8 years in prison? He did not hesitate. He answered with one word. You know what it is? Grace. Grace. That is how God turned Saul into Paul. That is how God turns sinners into saints. That's how God turns Marcus from a prisoner into this entrepreneur. I love this. He applied for 41 jobs. Couldn't get any of them. Why? Because they all asked if he had a felony on his record. Finally, he got an application that said, "Have you committed a felony in the last 7 years?" Well, he'd been in prison for 8 years, okay? So he was able to finally answer no. Gets a job at a paint store. Turns it into his own contracting business, and then starts something called Flick Shop, where families can send picture postcards to their loved ones in prison. Come on, somebody. Let me say this again for good measure. If you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You are justified just as if you had never sinned. No record of wrong. That is the grace of God. Would you let God grace you this weekend? Let me touch on peace. We'll unpack this idea a lot more, but peace is not passive. In Ephesians 4:3, Paul says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. It takes some blood, sweat, and tears. You have to fight for it. If you're married, you know what I'm talking about, okay? It is not easy. I want to paint a picture. In Mark's gospel, Jesus is on a boat. They're crossing the Sea of Galilee. And here's the deal. Sea of Galilee, 700 feet below sea level. And then you've got the Golan Heights to the east, 2,500 feet above sea level. And so the topography like creates these perfect storms. And so sure enough, a furious storm of hurricane proportions arose and the waves kept beating into the boat. Do you remember what happened? The disciples wake Jesus up. They are panicked, to say the least. And these are professional fishermen. What does Jesus do? Oh, it's one of my favorite moments in the Gospels. He gets up and he rebukes the wind and the waves. Peace, be still. You know what? This is a moment for those of us who follow Jesus to stay calm and carry on with faith, hope, and love. This week at work, I bet the winds are gonna blow. I bet someone is gonna make waves. Someone's gonna say something or do something that is gonna rock the boat. Now, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? It's a lot easier to act like a Christian than it is to react like one. A lot of us, we wake up, we panic. No, no, no. Let's be the people that shift the atmosphere, that say, peace, be still. Come on, you're gonna have an opportunity this week, and I'm believing that you're gonna show God's grace and peace. Now, I'm gonna close with this. 2018, Chadwick Boseman gave the commencement address at his alma mater, Howard University. He knew then what we know now. He had stage 4 colon cancer. Makes his words even more meaningful, even more powerful. By the way, in that speech, talks about a role he refused to play because it reinforced the stereotype that he was trying to change. Now that takes courage, and it takes something else. Are you ready? An extra measure of grace. It's the title of the message. It's my whole point this weekend. I just believe this is a moment where we need an extra measure of grace. How do you find the strength to play King T'Challa when cancer is ravaging your body? How in the world do you love on and encourage all of these kids with cancer when you know that you're dying from the same thing? I think it takes an extra measure of grace. We are the grace givers. We are the peacemakers. We're gonna talk more about it in our NCC Daily. I am out of time, Monday to Friday. We're gonna talk about passing the peace. How do we be these grace givers, peacemakers in our culture? But I'll quit with this. An old Welsh pastor named John Thomas said, "You supply the grit and God will supply the grace." I'm believing that for you this weekend. You're here and you've never experienced the grace of God. You mean the cross to Christ. He went to that cross because he wants to show you the full measure of his grace. Listen, it's as simple as confessing our sin and professing our faith. If that's you this weekend, you want to take a step of faith. You want to experience God's grace. Would you just raise a hand right now at our online campus? You'll see a button right there. And you're here and you need an extra measure of grace. As our band comes, we're just about to sing about it. Our prayer team is waiting to pray with you, to pray for you. You need that extra measure of grace. You need the peace that passes all understanding. I don't know all that you're going through. I know that all of us are fighting a battle that no one else knows about. But I know that his grace is sufficient. There's a little line in this song. I love it. Grace holds that ground. I believe grace is going to invade your life this weekend. The peace of God is going to invade your life. Heaven is going to invade earth. May his kingdom come. May his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hold me now in the hands I created the heavens. Come on, you say. Find me now where the grace runs as deep as your scars. You pull me from the clay. You send me on a rock. You call me by your name. You make my heart whole again. Lift it up. And my knees know it's all for your glory.
Come on, sing confidently.
That I might stand with more reasons to sing than to fear. You pull me from the clay. You send me on a rock. You call me. Surrender, I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. Once I was broken, but you love my whole heart through. Sin has no hold on me, 'cause your grace owns me.
God, you sing it out.
Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. 'Cause once I was broken, let me tell you, you love my whole heart through. Sin has no hold on me, 'cause your grace owns me now.
We sing this out. Here I stand in surrender.
Here I stand high in surrender. I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries. Come on, you surrender. Here I stand high in surrender. I need you. things are now. Death has no hold on me, 'cause your grace owns that ground, and your grace holds me now.
Ralphie.
Jesus went to a place called, caterpillar? Cappuccino? Carpe diem? I don't know what the place is called, but Jesus just went somewhere around the ocean.
When Jesus arrived, he went to a house.
When people heard he was there, they all gathered around him, and there was no room left.
It was more crowded than Disneyland. There's too many people at Disneyland.
Jesus began to teach them about the moon, stars, and rainbows.
As Jesus was teaching the people, four friends tried to bring the friend that couldn't walk to Jesus.
It was too crowded, so they went another way.
They put him on a trampoline and bounced him up on the roof.
When they got on the roof, they all pulled out swords and cut a hole in it.
They grabbed an axe and chopped. Chopped, chopped, chopped. They took out a chainsaw and cut a hole in it.
And they lowered the man who couldn't walk in front of Jesus.
When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "You guys are awesome," and he gave them a thumbs up.
Jesus told the man, "Your sins are forgiven." Some people heard what Jesus said.
Why did he say crazy things like that?
He's blaspheming. Blaspheming, whatever. They said to themselves,
"Only God can forgive sins."
Jesus knew what they were thinking.
What's easier to say? "Your sins are forgiven," or "get up and walk"?
So he told the man, "Get up and walk." The man got up and he said, "Yippee! Yay, I can walk." He got up and juggled a baseball bat. Dun 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 dun.
Everyone was amazed and excited.
They started juggling a baseball bat too. Dun 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 dun. As theme, the end.
That he gives one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the whole world through him. John 3:16 and 17. One and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the whole world through him. John 3:16 and 17.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside.
against the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Told a story about a Jewish man who lived in Jerusalem. One day, the man decided to visit his friends in Jericho. He set out on his journey, enjoying the beautiful sunshine.
What a great day for a long walk.
But on his journey, two robbers appeared from out of nowhere.
Somebody help!
The robbers took the man's stuff and beat him up. They left him laying beside the road, nearly dead. Soon, a priest came along on the road. This seemed like good news, since priests were known to be close to God and good helpers.
Please, help me.
But the priest saw the wounded man, and he pretended he didn't. Instead, he crossed to the other side of the road and kept walking. Next, a man who worked in the temple walked by. This seemed like good news. If this guy worked in the temple, he must be close to God and willing to help.
Please, help me.
But the temple assistant pretended not to see the man dying beside the road. He crossed to the other side of the road and kept walking. Next, a Samaritan came along. The Jewish man didn't expect him to stop. Everyone thought Samaritans weren't very nice or helpful. But the most unexpected thing happened. The Samaritan stopped. He got into the ditch with the Jewish man and bandaged his wounds.
Thank you for stopping to help.
The Samaritan loaded the hurt man onto his donkey and took him to an inn. He paid for the Jewish man's room and asked for them to take care of him. Do you think it's better to look like someone who helps others, or to actually be someone who helps others? Jesus asks us to be someone who helps, just like the Good Samaritan.
Yeah! give up.
Time for a Bible story. This is a story of a guy named Peter.
Whoa, that's awesome. This is one of my favorite stories.
Really?
Yeah, dude, I love Peter Pan. Flying around, fighting pirates and whatnot. Rufio!
Well, that's a great story, but we're actually talking about a different Peter.
Oh, cool. So it's Peter Parker then. He's awesome too. What up, Spidey?
Wrong again. This is a real story about a real guy from the Bible named Peter. You know, one of Jesus' disciples.
Oh, that Peter. Gotcha. So what's his deal?
Our story begins right before Jesus died on the cross. Up until this point, Peter and the other disciples followed Jesus all over the place as he taught people about God, healed the sick, and performed tons of miracles.
So Peter got to see everything Jesus did? Man, that would be so cool. I bet seeing all that stuff totally made him like a rock solid dude. He had to have amazing faith, huh?
Well, you'd think so. But even though Peter saw everything Jesus did, his faith actually started out kind of wimpy.
What? How come?
Well, before Jesus died on the cross and was raised back to life, People were just people. They didn't have any power over sin. Instead, sin had power over everybody. So that meant fear, doubt, and all kinds of junk had free reign in people's lives.
Okay, so what does that mean for Peter?
Here's an example. When Jesus was taken by the Roman soldiers, the disciples were close by in a crowd waiting to see what would happen. Three different people came up to Peter and said, "Hey, I recognize you. Aren't you one of Jesus' disciples?" But Peter lied to them all three times and denied knowing Jesus.
Wait, what? Wasn't he like one of Jesus' best friends?
Yep, but he still denied knowing Jesus so he wouldn't get into trouble himself.
What the Jim Jam, Peter man? Why did he do that?
Well, that's what I mean about how people didn't really have any power inside them. Peter's fear controlled him so much that he denied knowing Jesus.
Man, that really is some wimpy faith. So I guess he just like stayed wimpy like that, huh? Man, that's kind of a bummer.
Not exactly. Let's fast forward a little bit. Check this out. Peter stood up in front of thousands of people and told them all about Jesus. He wasn't afraid of what anybody thought, but instead he was filled with boldness and courage. That day, 3,000 people were saved and joined God's family.
Whoa, hold on. That's the same Peter we were talking about a second ago?
Yep.
That's amazing. He's like a totally different person. What happened?
I'll tell you what happened. Jesus happened. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, we're able to have his spirit inside of us. And that's what gives us power over sin. Before, Peter had wimpy faith, and fear totally controlled him. But after Jesus gave him a new spirit, he had the power.
Well, that's just a big old bottle of awesome sauce. So before, he was just like a regular Joe with wimpy little faith, and after, he turned into a beast mode, spirit-filled macho man.
Couldn't have said it better myself. And here's the cool part. This isn't just true for Peter back then. It's true for all of us today, too.
Whoa, really? That's awesome. So like when fear tries to push me around, I don't have to take it?
Nope. When Jesus gives you a new spirit, you've got the power.
I've got the power!
Exactly. Just like Peter, when we have the power of Jesus in us, we don't have to put up with fear. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah, it's like the coolest thing ever.
My thoughts exactly. The end.
Kleenex Watermelon vs. the Ride.
Intimidating.
It is flipping into.
Oh! Oh! That hurt like a dog.
Aaron?
No, I'm still.
Oh.
Of the Bible, Jesus washes his disciples' feet. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He healed many people from their sickness, performed many miracles like calming storms, and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses, when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus and his disciples went to Jerusalem to celebrate. Jesus had 12 men who followed him through his ministry. They were called his disciples. Jesus and his disciples gathered for one final meal together. Jesus got up from the table, took off his robe, and began to wash his disciples' feet. Jesus loved his disciples, and he knew the time was coming for him to leave them and return to heaven. When Jesus came to Peter, he said,
Wait!
Are you going to wash my feet? Jesus said, You don't understand what I'm doing now, but someday you will.
No!
Peter said, You will never wash my feet. But Jesus then told him that unless he washed his feet, he would not belong to him.
Oh, well then, okay!
Then Peter said, Then wash my hands and head as well, not just my feet. But Jesus told him that was not necessary. He just needed to wash his feet for Peter to become clean. So Jesus finished washing their feet and said that the disciples should do to others as he had done for them. He told them to follow the example that he had set for them, to serve each other and not think of themselves as greater than any other. Then God would bless them for doing as Jesus had taught them to do.
Hey, 5th and 6th graders, it's Abram, and I'm so excited to hang out with you today. Listen, I know you've probably been keeping up lately, but if not, I want you to know we've been in this series about the 4 B's. So if you've made it this far, you know, this is our last week. So you know, we believe in Jesus, you belong to a family, you're becoming a disciple, but this week, we're gonna switch it up a little bit. That's right, we're gonna switch it up a little bit, because this week, we're talking about building God's kingdom. What does it look like to build God's kingdom? Yes, I believe, I belong, I've become, but what does it look like to build? So let me tell you a story. I have a friend, his name is Isaac. We all have friends or no, we have friends who have parents. They're handy guys, you know? They're handy with their hands, they can fix things. I'm not this guy. Isaac is this guy. In fact, to this day, now he builds houses for a living. But one day, I was 16 years old, we're in high school, and I thought, I need to make a little extra money, okay? And so I go out in the Texas heat, and I decide I'm going to attempt to build a shed with Isaac. A little shed over, I think it was a water well, I'm not even sure. But what I do know is that I didn't know what I was doing. I showed up, Isaac, tool belt, my other buddy, tool belt, hammers. They had all these things in their hands they were using, you name it. So I had a decision to make. They're gonna hand me these tools. Do I act like I know what I'm doing, or do I just tell the truth? I remember it like it was yesterday. I'm standing in the foundation of this shed with a hammer in my hand and another tool that measures something. No idea, I'm sweating. I've been there an hour. I'm literally sweating purely because of the heat. I don't even know that I've done any work at this point. But I'm standing there and I decide, you know what? I really just don't know what I'm doing. Isaac, I'm sorry, I will hand you the tools, but I'm sitting here with this stuff in my hand and I do not know the next step to take. And that's what I think it's like for a lot of us when we talk about building God's kingdom. You've heard all these messages. It's like, okay, I believe in Jesus. Awesome, I belong to a family. It's great, I'm becoming a disciple. I'm a follower of Jesus, so what do I do now? One of my favorite verses in the Bible when it talks about this, Matthew 4:17, from that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I love that Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He could have said anything there. He could have said the kingdom of heaven is awesome. The kingdom of heaven is paved with streets of gold. He could have said any of that, but that's not what he said. He said the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Another time later in scripture when Jesus is teaching us how to pray, he says, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." I think that's so important if we're going to talk about building God's kingdom. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. I'll do a little experiment for you. Right now, wherever you are, I want you to think about things just every day that you use with your hands, okay? Maybe it's your Bible. I hope that it is your Bible. If you put your Bible in your hand, what do? You open it. You read your Bible. Maybe you get a little hungry. You're eating a little snack. What do? You grab some food. What do? You take the Pringle. You eat the Pringle. I'm not gonna eat the Pringle right now because I'm trying to lose a little bit of weight. Or maybe you wanna play some sports. You take a little racket. When you put things in your hand, it requires action. And what I think is so cool that Jesus said the kingdom of God is at hand is because he knew, I need them to know that what I'm asking them to build, they actually have possession of and they can do something with it. If I walked around all day with this in my hand and did nothing with it, you'd probably call me crazy. You'd probably tell me I didn't know what I was doing. Well, maybe it looks like the same as a believer, as a Christian, when the kingdom of God is in your hands. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So if the kingdom of God is at hand, what is your next action? What does it mean to build if the kingdom of God is in your hand? Let's think about this for a little bit. Maybe for you, the kingdom of God, building the kingdom of God, just looks like being kind to a neighbor. Maybe building the kingdom of God for you looks like telling your friends and family about Jesus. The beautiful thing about the kingdom of God is that God just doesn't ask you to come and chill out and hang out with him and have a relationship with him, which is a beautiful thing. But he actually wants you to play a part in the kingdom. Yes, you can hang out, you can chill with him. One of my favorite things to do is have quiet time with the Lord. I even did it today. But to build the kingdom looks like what I'm doing right now. Think about this. You may not even know me, and I may not even know you. But today, building the kingdom for me looks like this. I wonder what building the kingdom looks like for you. I mean, think about this for me. I'm sitting at that shed. I've got a hammer in my hand, and I do not know what to do with it. Maybe that's you today. Maybe you know that you believe in Jesus. You know that you belong to a family. You know that you're becoming a disciple and you're just wondering what's next. And that's where build comes into play. Those first three things we talked about have a lot to do with me, a lot to do with what God is doing inside of me. But to build is an outward expression of what God is doing on the inside. So maybe today, building the kingdom looks like being kind to your friends. Maybe building the kingdom looks like going up to mom and dad and saying, "Hey, I'm so sorry." Maybe it looks like looking around and seeing what friends and family may not know a lot about Jesus and what you could share with them. For me personally, building the kingdom is actually just a self-realization, a self-awareness that, man, I believe in Jesus. That changed my life. I became a part of the family. That changed my life. I'm becoming a disciple. That has changed my life. It would be selfish of me to realize those three things and not want to build and bring others along. It would be selfish for me to go, "You know what? I'm gonna keep this secret. I'm going to heaven all by myself." No, I want to bring as many people with me as possible. So ask yourself today, how do I build the kingdom? All these things I have in my hand, maybe you have the racket in your hand, whatever the spiritual thing that God has done inside of your heart, ask yourself, what am I gonna do now? For me today, it might look like going to the grocery store and being kind to the person when I check out. It might be going through the drive-thru, I love Canes, it might be going through Canes and saying, "Thank you so much, have a blessed day." I think we get these big ideas that building the kingdom has to be all these huge aspirations, and those are great and they're true. But I think it starts with loving your neighbor. Looking at the person around you, saying, "Hey, I love you, I care about you." Call that friend you haven't talked to all quarantine long, ask them how they're doing. But ultimately, realize, man, God has done this in my life. I believe in Jesus. I belong to the family. I'm becoming a disciple, and now I'm going to build the kingdom. Love you guys. See you soon.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets.
Heal our streets and land. Save.